Hi class, I'm sorry that I can't be with you again today. This is the online lecture of Chapter 5 on Civil Rights. So let's continue our discussion about civil liberties and civil rights because they do go hand in hand, although they are different. Now last class we discussed civil liberties. In preparation for this class on civil rights, we also discussed the differences between civil liberties and civil rights. They're often confused. So civil liberties, if you remember, refer to freedoms expressed in the Bill of Rights. Also, the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment. If you remember, the Due Process Clause forbids any state from denying life, liberty, or property to any person without the due process of law. So again, civil liberties are rooted in the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment. Now, civil rights protect us from discrimination. They are rooted in the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment. And I don't believe the book gives a definition for the Equal Protection Clause, so let me do that for you. It provides that no state shall deny to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws. The Due Process Clause and the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment have opened us up to challenge the state and federal government in areas of liberty, by that I mean civil liberties, and equal treatment. By that I mean civil rights. In short, civil liberties can limit what the government can do to you. Civil rights can protect you from discrimination by both the government and individuals. Let's probe a little more into civil liberties before we discuss civil rights. Now, I discussed selective incorporation quite a bit last class. If you remember, selective incorporation is the process by which civil liberties from the Bill of Rights are applied to state laws on a case-by-case basis. So in other words, this allows state laws to be subject to the liberties expressed in the Bill of Rights. It wasn't always that way. Until 1834, Massachusetts had a state church. This might be surprising because it's contradictory to the First Amendment's Establishment Clause. Pull over and stop for a second. The Establishment Clause is the part of the First Amendment that states Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, which means Congress can't sponsor or favor a religion. However, at the time the Bill of Rights applied, only to laws that the federal government passed. So the state government could, Massachusetts could, by law, establish a state church, if that's what the citizens wanted. The selective incorporation definition specifies that the Bill of Rights have applied to the states on a case-by-case basis. So case-by-case basis is key here. It's important to note because what it's saying is that individual parts of the Bill of Rights were incorporated to the states one by one and certainly not all at one time. For example, look at Table 4.1. We saw this last Wednesday in class. In your book, you see the freedom of the press portion of the First Amendment was incorporated to apply to the state laws in 1931. However, another part of the First Amendment, the right to petition government, wasn't incorporated until later, 1939. Similarly, you'll see the right to bear arms didn't apply to the states until 2010. So it seems to be the trend then that as the Supreme Court continues to take up cases involving state laws and the Bill of Rights, more amendments, more portions of the amendments will be incorporated and applied to state laws. Now, in all the cases listed in your book in Table 4.1, Gitlow v. New York, Wolf v. Colorado, Washington v. Texas, just to name a few, the premise of the case being brought to the Supreme Court was the 14th Amendment, specifically the Due Process Clause. When we think civil liberties, I want you to think Due Process Clause. So let me give you a few opinions that were written by the justices whenever they ruled on these cases. For example, Gitlow v. New York, Justice Sanford wrote, "For the present purposes, we may and do assume that freedom of speech and of the press, which are protected by the First Amendment from the abridgment by Congress, are among the fundamental personal rights and liberties protected by the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment from impairment by the states. So, 14th Amendment Due Process Clause is applying to the states. In Wolf v. Colorado, another one that your book names, Justice Frankfurter wrote, "The security of one's privacy against arbitrary intrusion by the police, which is at the core of the 4th Amendment, is basic to a free society. It is therefore implicit in the concept of ordered liberty, and as such, enforceable against the states through the Due Process Clause," which again is a part of the 14th Amendment. Now, the Due Process Clause does not give the courts blanket authority to assume that every single Bill of Rights applies to the states, and that the states should always be subject to the Bill of Rights. This is why I mentioned that it was a case-by-case basis. In fact, the Supreme Court has tests to determine whether the states can be implicated in denying rights. Your book talks about one of the tests, specifically the Lemon Test. It's not used now, but it was used up until 1984, to determine whether a practice by government, any practice by a government, violates the Establishment Clause. And so they would ask, the Supreme Court that is, first, does the practice of government have a secular legislative purpose? Then they would ask, does the practice either advance or inhibit religion? Then they would ask, does it foster the practice of government, that is, an excessive government entanglement with religion? And so the answers to these questions help determine whether a state law violated the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment. And subsequently, other tests were used to determine whether state government acts were unconstitutional. So these tests that we see are very useful to the Supreme Court to help establish the application of precedent that they set. So other justices in the future then can look to these tests in order to maintain a continuity in the justice system, that the same aspects of law were applied to one case or also applied to another case. The Free Exercise Clause, let's talk about that. It's not always been as cut and dry as most cases. The Free Exercise Clause is the part of the First Amendment that Congress cannot prohibit or interfere with the practice of religion. So, for example, the Supreme Court is asked, is animal sacrifice protected by the First Amendment? They say, yes. Can Mormons have multiple wives? According to the Supreme Court, no. Can religion get you out of the draft during wartime? Supreme Court says yes, but with certain conditions. By the way, those conditions are that your belief against war has to be against war across the board. So you have to have a moral conviction against all wars and not just the premise of one particular war. Another case, do Amish parents have to send their kids to school beyond the eighth grade? No. So we see that the Supreme Court is kind of case-by-case basis waffled on how exactly the Free Exercise Clause is to be interpreted. There are more tests, though, that the court employs in instances of civil liberties and even civil rights, we'll see later. Two of the tests are strict scrutiny and intermediate scrutiny. Now, for strict scrutiny, the law must be shown to serve a compelling state interest or a goal, and it must be the restrictive or the most restrictive means of achieving that goal. I'll be more specific later. Intermediate scrutiny is, of course, less strict as what I just named. To determine whether a law is constitutional, the law must be content neutral, and it must further an important government interest in a way that is substantially related to that interest. In addition, the means to accomplish that goal should not be excessive or broader than is necessary to meet that goal. It's not usual for anyone to think about what the First Amendment does not cover. What I mean is, we have freedom of speech. So does that mean that we have the right to say whatever we want to say at any time? Certainly so. There may be consequences outside of the government too, though. For example, if you call somebody poor eyes because they wear glasses, you could be told off by that person or given a firm talking to by somebody else who heard you call them names. Or, and just in general, you may hurt someone's feelings. These are all general consequences of saying things, but can the government disallow certain forms of speech? I don't know about calling somebody four eyes, but the answer is yes. The First Amendment has its limitations. It doesn't protect, for example, slander, libel, or obscenity. Fighting words, quote-unquote, are not allowed, though it's hard for the courts to determine what exactly qualifies as, quote-unquote, fighting words. These, according to your book, are forms of expression that, by their very utterance, can incite violence. Hate speech, also banned. Hate speech, according to your book, is an expression that is offensive or abusive, particularly in terms of race, gender, or sexual orientation. Now, this is a great segue to discuss Tocqueville's take on freedom versus equality. Last class, I mentioned Tocqueville's assessment of America in 1824, long before the 14th Amendment was passed, and prior to many Supreme Court cases that discussed the need for equality of any kind. And he says, if you remember, a continuum where equality and freedom cannot meet. In fact, they go in opposite directions. And as we seek freedom, we give up equality. When we seek equality, we must give up some freedom. So let me read you a quote from Tocqueville in Democracy in America. He says, "I think that democratic communities have a natural taste for freedom. Left to themselves, they'll seek it, cherish it, and view any privation of it with regret. But for equality, their passion is ardent, insatiable, incessant, invincible. They call for equality and freedom, and if they can't obtain that, they still call for equality and slavery. They will endure poverty, servitude, barbarism, but they will not endure aristocracy. This is true at all times, especially in our own day." And again, pulling over for a second, he's writing in 1824. He continues to say, "All men and all powers seeking to cope with this irresistible passion," meaning equality, "will be overthrown and destroyed by it. In our age, freedom cannot be established without it, it being equality, and despotism itself cannot reign without equality support." Well, we all want to be treated equally. This is not Tocqueville talking right now. We all want to be treated equally well, right? And as a result, we consent to things, or we consent to the ruling, for example, that slander and libel are criminal, even though it means that it denies us from saying particular things. It keeps us from saying things that are slanderous and libelous. But we submit to that, and we consent to that because of our desire to be treated equally well. We agree to submit to the laws against hate speech and laws against obscenity. We do this even though obscenity isn't even well defined. And then think about fighting words that I described earlier. They're incredibly subjective, even to the courts. And yet we, again, submit ourselves to these rules. So we've given up some of our freedoms for the sake of equality, and that's what Tocqueville is saying. This is a great point to begin discussing civil rights. So remember, civil rights protect us from discrimination. They are rooted in the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment. And one more time, the Equal Protection Clause provides that no state shall deny to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of laws. Affirmative action is a great example of the tension between liberty and equality. The Civil Rights Act in 1964, for example, did not fix some forms of inequality between African Americans and Caucasians. So affirmative action was intended to create equal opportunity for the purpose of socioeconomic equality. Now, sometimes this means extra effort to recruit women or minorities in the workforce or at universities. In fact, some workplaces have to meet specific quotas of an unrepresented class. And to allow certain individuals equal opportunity, some of us give up freedom. An even better example, and this takes us back to civil liberties, are what we often give up in times of national crises and in times of war. For example, the Patriot Act took away many rights to privacy, but individuals gladly part with that for the protection that they receive from the national government. And that's often the case that in times of war, people are generally far more willing to give up their freedom in terms of protection. All right, now let's turn back to the 14th Amendment because it is the star of the lesson this week and last Wednesday. We wanted to discuss its importance on civil rights. So the 14th Amendment passed just after the Civil War. This amendment was among, obviously, the 13th and 15th Amendment, but all three of those together, we call them the Civil War Amendments. These together, again, gave rights to African Americans. And I think it's worth asking whether those who introduced the amendment intended for the 14th Amendment to be quite as trailblazing as it is today. Objectively, the 14th Amendment expanded the power of the federal government. Now we see that today more now than in the past. So now the federal government can impose laws that were meant to be only for the federal government. They can impose them on state governments. Did those who introduced the law know this would be used to further the power of the federal government? Well, I think the answer is yes, or at least history gives us reason to believe that. So let's examine the passage of the 14th Amendment. First, remember what the amendment did. It made all persons born in the U.S., citizens of the U.S., the state they reside in, and I'm paraphrasing here, but it prohibited states from denying certain privileges and rights. More specifically, within the 14th Amendment, we have the important Due Process Clause, which we link with civil liberties. This facilitated the selective incorporation of civil liberties. And then the Equal Protection Clause, which facilitated legal protection against discrimination. Right, first and foremost, the 14th Amendment was intended to achieve equality for ex-slaves. This was a fulfillment to the Civil War's ending commitment. Now, I want you to think back about our book's description about politics in the first chapter. Remember that politics is about conflict, power, who gets what, when, and how much. Let's see if this is the case for the 14th Amendment. Now, the 14th Amendment was initiated and passed by Republicans. And don't get too hung up on political parties right now. What we want to focus on are the desires to stay in power by, in general, all political parties. In fact, so it was passed unanimously, that is, the 14th Amendment was, passed unanimously by Republicans. So at the end of the Civil War and throughout the Union, or the Union's difficulty to reassemble as a unified nation then, Republicans were in power in Congress and in the presidency. So let me say that again. So here we are at the end of the Civil War, and we're amongst the difficulty that we're facing in trying to reassemble as a unified nation, and we have, again, Republicans in power in Congress and in the presidency. Did the Republicans have anything to gain by passing the 14th Amendment? Of course. When policy's passed, somebody has something to gain, and you can also bet that somebody might lose, too. Yes, in fact, the passing of the 14th Amendment ensured that the Republicans would remain in power in the next election cycle. So far, I've only read Section 1, or we've only read Section 1 of the 14th Amendment, but there are actually four sections. And Sections 2, 3, and 4 were very much intended to punish those states who left the Union during the Civil War. Section 2 was intended to enforce black suffrage. It completely outlawed the Three-Fifths Compromise. Section 3 prevented rebels from holding state or federal offices with conditions until Congress said, okay, you can run now, you're no longer rebellious to our nation. And Section 4 made sure that all that debt that the Confederacy incurred under the war would never be included or paid for through the U.S. debt. Or with U.S. money. In all, if the Republicans could make it so that African Americans can vote, then the Republicans would stay in power. The Republican Party was the Union Party. Remember, the Union Party freed the slaves. So, African Americans would likely vote for the Republicans if they could vote. That being the case, this would prevent the Southern Democrats from enveloping the majority or even a portion of Congress during the next election, and as a result, completely undoing everything the Republicans did. Since they were already in power, they being the Republicans, it behooved them then to expand the powers of the federal government in order to stay in power. Now, all of this is to say, or all of this is not to say, that there weren't any Republicans that had noble intentions. No, many did. But power at the federal level was certainly a motivating factor, and that's just what I wanted to point out. Opponents to the 14th Amendment were, of course, Democrats. Now, I found a condensed list of their grievances about the amendment, why they opposed it, some of which are pretty valid. At first, they argued that it disallowed previous Confederate soldiers from public office, which prohibited them, subsequently, from serving their Southern constituents effectively. Secondly, the Civil War just ended, and the nation was in an upheaval. They're trying to reassemble as a union, like I said earlier. The Democrats argued that the times were too turbulent to decide on amendments like this to the Constitution. They wanted to wait till the dust had settled, so to speak. Third, Section 1, they said, was a radical change and would lead to the abolition of state governments. Fourth and finally, they said the entire process was undemocratic in nature because the people that it affected the most, the South, had no say in it. Now, it's worth noting that the Democrats, like the Republicans, were grappling to get power and to stay in power. These amendments, specifically the 14th Amendment, made the Democrats powerless. Now, in the end, we see that the 14th Amendment certainly expanded the federal government, but not until years later. For years after the 14th Amendment was ratified, the Supreme Court very narrowly interpreted the 14th Amendment. Narrowly interpreted meaning that they paid no attention to it. It seems it was intended to apply to the states, as we read in class on Wednesday, because it talks specifically to the states, but the Supreme Court didn't allow it. So the Supreme Court may have followed the opposition's reasoning, the opposition's meaning the Democrats' reasoning. Certainly we know that the Supreme Court, at least for a while, gave very little, if no authority, to the 14th Amendment, the Due Process Clause, or the Equal Protection Clause. Remember that between 1876 and 1964, states were still permitted to pass Jim Crow laws. These are laws by the state and local government that mandated, or better said, legalized racial segregation in public facilities. Here, the Supreme Court had an opportunity to prevent this in 1883 when they heard the case involving the 1875 Civil Rights Act. The Supreme Court, though, chose to rule that Congress had no authority to make private businesses cease discrimination. So there was their chance to incorporate the 14th Amendment, the Due Process Clause, the Equal Protections Clause, and they didn't. Then again, we have Plessy v. Ferguson in 1896, during which the Supreme Court established the separate but equal doctrine. The courts interpreted that, according to the 14th Amendment, segregation was certainly constitutional as long as the facilities were equal. So again, we have the Supreme Court not supporting the 14th Amendment. When we discuss civil rights, we usually discuss the plight of slavery in America and then the subsequent systematic institutionalized discrimination. Well, civil rights has expanded, of course, to all forms of discrimination and to all sort of groups. And the courts have acknowledged and continue to acknowledge these other groups that suffer or who have suffered and continue to from discrimination. Now, your book talks about several groups. Native Americans, first of all, who were pushed from their homelands by the federal government in the early development of our country. Even though the federal government agreed to treat them as a domestic but sovereign nation, the U.S. frequently wouldn't uphold their treaties. And in 1830, the U.S. removed all Native Americans from the South to Oklahoma, and on that Trail of Tears, it's called, many Native Americans died. Your book says it's actually only been recent that the U.S. has begun to consistently uphold their treaties and agreements with Native Americans. Your book also talks about Latinos. Now, Latinos are now America's largest minority. And as we discuss discrimination of Latinos, we also have the opportunity to explore how civil rights are sometimes not as clear-cut as one might think. Sometimes it is. For example, we can all agree that slavery is wrong. But consider this. Let's discuss the 2010 Senate Bill 1070 in the Arizona State Legislature. The bill was entitled Support Our Law Enforcement and Safe Neighborhoods Act, and it targeted immigration. The legislation was very controversial and was said to lead to racial stereotyping. So let's discuss the specifics of the law. First, U.S. law already required, U.S. federal law that is, required that aliens over the age of 18 who were here in the U.S. for more than 30 days must register with the U.S. government and have papers, their papers, in possession of them at all times. If this is violated, it's a federal misdemeanor. The Arizona state law, SB 1070, made it a state misdemeanor crime too. However, the Arizona law required that law enforcement officers determine immigration status during any lawful stop when there's a reasonable suspicion the individual may be illegal. It also barred state officials and agencies from restricting in any way the enforcement of federal law regarding immigration, rather. Finally, penalties were given to anyone sheltering, hiring, transporting unregistered aliens. And once again, the major concern with this law was racial profiling. And as a result, the Department of Justice challenged its constitutionality. And there were 7 lawsuits in total over this particular law. In 2012, one of the cases before the Supreme Court held in Arizona v. United States that requiring immigration checks during lawful stops was indeed constitutional. But they also struck down some other parts of the law as violations of the Supremacy Clause, meaning that it conflicted with some of the federal laws. Now recently, as recent as last Friday, September 4th, 2 more provisions of the law required a ruling from a U.S. district court. First, there was a provision requiring state and local police to determine immigration status. Then, there was the requirement for immigration status to be verified with the federal government for anyone who was arrested. U.S. District Court Judge Susan Bolton ruled there was no indication that law enforcement officials would treat Latinos differently. How is this so? Well, let's go back to 2010 when the bill was passed. So a few days after the initial bill, SB 70, was passed, the Arizona State Legislature amended it, meant that prosecutors would not investigate complaints based on race, color, or national origin. How is it that the case of Senate Bill 1070 is not clear-cut in terms of civil rights? Well, I would ask you to think about how can you really suspect someone of being an immigrant at a traffic stop? Okay, but before we answer that question, Arizona legislatures claim to be dealing with an immigration problem, not a race problem. Their borders, according to them, were not being properly protected by the federal government. So they passed this law to take matters into their own hands and hopefully force the federal government into dealing. Now let's talk about judicial activism. So justices being active in creating circumstances for equality, or just in general, creating equality. In 1992, 15 new U.S. House districts were drawn. These were drawn to help elect African-American representatives, and 10 were drawn to help elect Latinos. This was a result of 1982 amendments to the Voting Rights Act of 1965. The amendment prohibited violating voting rights based on racial discrimination, whether or not the procedures intended to discriminate or not. So in regularly drawn districts, if it prevented an African American or a Latino from being elected, when there was a significant number in that area, even if it wasn't intended to discriminate, they had to redraw the district. So we have a case then in 1993. This is Shaw versus Reno, where North Carolina was redistricted. So they redistricted and they sent the new map, but it was to the federal level, but it was rejected by the U.S. Attorney General because it only had one black majority district. So North Carolina redrew a second black district. And subsequently, the Supreme Court took up the case when 5 North Carolina citizens claimed that the state had racially gerrymandered a district. The question for the courts was whether or not it was a valid constitutional issue under the 14th Amendment, the Equal Protection Clause, this racially gerrymandered district. The court ruled, ultimately, yes, it was a valid constitutional issue. So they ended up sending the case back to the district level to determine whether there was a compelling government interest in keeping the seemingly racially gerrymandered district. Now, moving on to affirmative action, which we've already discussed a little bit, is Gratz versus Bullinger. Jennifer Gratz was a student who applied to the University of Michigan as an undergraduate. She had a GPA of 3.8, an ACT score of 25. And this was in 1995. Then we have another student, 1997, Patrick Kammacher, who applied, and he had a 3.0 GPA and an ACT score of 28. Now, the university has a policy to admit virtually all qualified candidates who are members of one of these three select groups, either African Americans, Hispanics, Native Americans. I think I might have told you this about this case last Wednesday. The guidelines of the admission process at the University of Michigan is based on a variety of factors. Now, race is one of those factors, but all of those factors add up to 100 points. And once you're at the threshold of 100 points, then you're guaranteed acceptance. But if you were in one of the three select groups, the African American, Hispanic, or Native American groups, then you were added an automatic additional 20 points, which would often get you to that 100-point threshold. So it went to the courts. Michigan said that promoting diversity is a compelling state interest. And indeed, the Supreme Court agreed. It's a compelling state interest. What they didn't agree with was the admission selection process, did it violate the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment? And the answer was yes, because it wasn't individualistic enough in selecting its candidates. Now, here's an example of what would have been okay. Well, actually, before I go into that, let's talk about what courts use to determine discrimination. Right. So, for instances of race, ethnicity, creed, or national origin, we see the strict scrutiny test, which we just talked about. We found this in our Civil Liberties chapter 2. There's two questions that are asked here, and if you remember, I mentioned when I breezed over strict scrutiny before that we would discuss it a little later. So now is later. So here are two questions that the courts ask themselves when they're determining whether something's unconstitutional in regards to race, ethnicity, creed, or national origin. One, is it unequal treatment justified by a state interest? Secondly, is unequal treatment the least restrictive option in order to meet that state interest? Now, if the answer is yes to both, the discrimination is perfectly legal. So this is where I was going to go before I went into how the courts determine discrimination. I wanted to tell you about the Grutter versus Bollinger case in 2003. This is another case about affirmative action at the University of Michigan. And this is also a rare instance where they found, for the strict scrutiny test, that the discrimination was, in fact, legal. So here's what happened. In 1997, Barbara Grutter was denied admission to the University of Michigan Law School. She had a 3.8 GPA and a 161 LSAT score, which is quite high. The law school admitted that race was certainly a factor in the admissions process because diversity, or at least achieving diversity, was a compelling state interest. Now, the court ruled, whenever Grutter sued, the court ruled it did not violate Equal Protection Clause because it conducts, the school conducts, that is, a highly individualized review of each applicant. So while race plays a factor, it's not the only factor that can automatically make you eligible to be admitted. So this is a case, then, the opposite of what happened in the other University of Michigan case, Gratz versus Bollinger, where the strict scrutiny case showed that this kind of discrimination was legal. All right, so what happens then if the answer to strict scrutiny is no to one of the questions that I asked? If the answer is no to any of the questions, then discrimination is not legal, i.e. Gratz v. Bollinger, which meant that the way that Michigan's admissions process was at the undergraduate level was unconstitutional, as opposed to their admissions process at the legal, at the law school level, where it was constitutional. The second test that the Supreme Court uses to determine constitutionality in cases of civil rights. This is involving cases about sex or gender equality. And they typically use intermediate scrutiny, again, something that we discussed in the previous chapter. But in terms of civil rights, they ask two questions. Is the policy, or is the discriminatory policy, quote, substantially related to a, quote, important government objective? And then number two, is discrimination no greater than necessary to achieve that objective? So if yes, discrimination is legal. Example being, Michael M. v. Superior Court. This case took place in 1981. So SCOTUS, the Supreme Court of the United States, in this case, upheld a California state law that men, but not women, could be guilty of statutory rape. They said the state has a very strong interest in preventing illegitimate pregnancies and in punishing the one who by nature suffers the fewest of these consequences would help that state interest. And finally, the third test we're going to talk about is the rational basis test. This is often used in cases, civil rights cases based on age. So the rational basis test, two questions. Number one, is the law rationally related to furthering a legitimate government interest? We're seeing a pattern here, right? We want to know if the discrimination laws actually furthers a state interest. If it does, it could be constitutional. Number two, does the policy avoid arbitrary, capricious, or deliberate discrimination? If yes, discrimination is legal. If no, discrimination is not legal. So here's an example where discrimination is not legal in this instance, because actually rational basis test is fairly easy to pass, well, according to some. So Craig v. Boren, case in 1976. Oklahoma laws, the state laws, prohibited non-intoxicating 3.2% beer sales to men who were under the age of 21. They also prohibited that same 3.2 beer sales to women, but only under the age of 18. So there was an age gap there. If you were a man and you were 20, tough luck. If you were a woman and you were 20, then yeah, you could have it. Curtis Craig sued that the law violated the Equal Protection Clause because of the different drinking ages for women and men. So here's what the court ruled. It was certainly unconstitutional, this Oklahoma state law, because it simply made generalities about the drinking habits of two different aggregate groups, and it was certainly not sufficient evidence of a difference between the group at all. Now, it's difficult to talk about civil liberties without talking about presidential authority and their power regarding civil rights. What can they do? That is, the president's, the current sitting president. In the past, they've done quite a bit. In fact, in 1948, Truman integrated, single-handedly, the integration of armed services, integrated armed services, with African Americans and all different races. In 1957, President Eisenhower used the National Guard in Arkansas to force desegregation in a school. In 1961, and then later in 65, first Kennedy, then LBJ, Lyndon B. Johnson, issued executive orders in favor of affirmative action. And then President Clinton, Bill Clinton, tried to end a ban on gay marriage in the military. Now, he attempted to end it. Presidents before him had had some luck with this. He, however, was attempting to end it with legislation, not executive orders, or just simply employing the National Guard to stop it. The result, though, was a lose-lose for everybody. The resulting policy was the don't tell or don't ask, don't tell legislation. In this instance, the military would not actively search for homosexuals to kick them out, and if you didn't ask, they wouldn't tell you. This didn't do well for people who wanted to end the ban on gay marriage in the military and those who didn't. Now, later, President Obama pushed Congress to repeal the Don't Ask, Don't Tell Act, and in 2011, Congress passed the law. So we see then that the presidents can use executive orders, or at least what we would call the bully pit, just being able to get up in front of the United States and put an issue on the agenda. So presidents, again, can at least use executive orders or the bully pit to put civil rights issues on the agenda. And this is, again, what President Obama did. In general, presidents can have a huge role in making sure that civil rights are expanded. But who has the most authority, though, we see, is the Supreme Court, because they can determine how expanded the 14th Amendment Equal Protection Clause is and how much to expand the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment as well. Another thing that civil rights issues, well, another thing that the Supreme Court really follows is public opinion. So, generally, if public opinion is in favor of a particular civil right or a particular civil liberty, and if it gets enough attention, then in time, the Supreme Court usually follows that opinion. All right, that's the end of my lecture. Thank you for listening, and I will see you on Wednesday.